sing together, "The Christian Men Rejoice."
Christmas Day service in Yost Hall tomorrow morning, and you're all welcome to come and be nice and cozy with one another there. I also want to thank Rosemary's crew for coming. I think this is a tradition now that they come every year and help us sing, so we really appreciate it. Thank you.
Prepare your hearts for worship.
Merry Christmas to you all.
Merry Christmas.
Candles you have before you are the candles that were lit at the service of hope, and these candles represent the prayers of the people who came. It's prayers for family, friends, situations. One candle sitting on the corner by itself is a prayer that is lit so that prayer is offered on your behalf, that you will find the true joy of Christmas this year. So that is your candle. I'm going to ask that you join me in our call to worship, and as we relight the candles from the Advent wreath, I'll ask this. We gather to celebrate the birth of the one who is the light of the world.
We are here to worship God and His Son, Jesus Christ, born this night in Bethlehem of Judea.
We light the candle of hope to remind us of the promise made by all the prophets that God would raise up a Savior for His people Israel, and through Him bless all the nations.
Let the heavens and the earth rejoice. Our Lord has come.
We light the candle of peace to remind us that the Prince of Peace comes to enlighten those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death.
Let the heavens and the earth rejoice. Our Lord has come.
We light the candle of joy to remind us that the Lord has made known his salvation, and that grace is poured out upon us.
Let the heavens and the earth rejoice. Our Lord has come.
We light the candle of love to remind us that God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him might have eternal life.
Let the heavens and the earth rejoice. Our Lord has come.
We light the Christ candle to celebrate and rejoice that the light of the world is born this night.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come.
The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them a light has shone. You, O Lord, have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. For unto us a child is born, and unto us a son is given. And the government shall be upon his shoulder. He is called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace.
Glory be to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to all people of good will. Hallelujah.
Amen. Joy to the world. God of grace, for you are God of grace, God of mercy, for you are God of mercy. We come before you on this holy of nights. We come with wonder and amazement that you could love us this much. That you would come as a child to be a part of our world, to live among us, and to bring God's redemption for each of us. Lord, help us to hear the words of the prophets. Help us to hear the stories of those who attended your birth. And help us to hear your words of love that now given to us, we must share. Accept us into your presence. And hear us as we rejoice in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Lord, we pray this in your most holy name. Amen. Infant holy, infant low. Stories tonight are met in two ways by our world. Some meet these stories with reverence and faith, and some meet them at the very best with tradition. I pray tonight that the Holy Spirit will come upon these words, and that you'll find more than tradition. I pray that you'll find hope and love within them. Let us pray. As we turn to these words, open our hearts, open our minds, and let us not just hear a familiar story. Let us hear your voice. Amen. Isaiah chapter 9, verses 2 to 7. Let us hear God's word. The people who walk in darkness have seen a great light. And those who live in the land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation, you have increased its joy. They rejoice before you, as with joy at the harvest, as people exult with when dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden, and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, ye have broken as on the day of Midian. For all the boots of the tramping warrior and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and righteousness from this time forward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. Amen. That prophecy comes from a time when the people had turned away from God. When their private and their public life displayed little knowledge or even little acceptance of God. Politically, these people were little more than just a tributary nation to the Assyrian Empire. And their future didn't look very promising. But the prophet Isaiah wanted the people to learn that God had not abandoned them. In fact, God was sending to them a great king. He would be the Messiah. He would bring hope. He would bring peace. He would bring restoration of the nation. He would return the people to their God, and he would make them a great nation once again. And they would lead all the people to God. His kingdom and his rule would be like none other. The whole of the created order would change. And his kingdom, when he came, would never end. It would be an earthly kingdom, but it would also be a spiritual kingdom. Because the Lord God of hosts would be the very one to bring it in. And we're told the people would not walk in darkness any longer. And it seems as if we look around the world today, we're still walking in that darkness. And we're not walking in the light of the Messiah. And we wonder why that is. And perhaps it takes us right back to the beginning of that prophecy when the people had walked away from God. For you see, the prophecy is only fulfilled through us. If we're not willing to walk in the light of that Christ child. We'll continue to walk in darkness. But that's our hope, that we will. Hark the glad sound. Christmas story from Luke. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. Now, this was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and the family of David. And he went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. And while they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child. She gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. And in that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. For see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told to them. Amen. The promised light did come. And as John says in his gospel, the light came into the world, but you know what? We didn't recognize it. Because it came into a world that still existed in darkness. And it's hard to recognize because it came in the form of a small child, born to a young woman back in the sticks. He came in the dark of the night. And his birth was hardly known of anyone but a few shepherds. He came in a time when a tyrant king wanted no opposition to his throne and was willing to kill every male child in his kingdom. But yet, his birth, this is a fascinating part of this story. His birth was heralded from the heavens. The heavenly hosts, the angels, sang his glory. The heavens displayed his brightness, and all creation rejoiced. We're told that sometime in the next few years, wise men sought him. They came looking for him. The lowly, they spoke about it. Mary wondered. But God entered our world in such a way. And we listen to the story and we think, it's quaint, it's quiet, it's turned into something that the scriptures didn't make it into. It really is an extremely simple story. God entered our world as a child in Bethlehem. The angels sang his glory. And the shepherds, the lowest of the low in the world, were the ones that the angels came to. They told a handful of shepherds that God had been born in our world. Would have been better had he gone into a great cathedral and told everybody there. Didn't happen. Shepherds looking after sheep in the night. But did you see how Luke told that story? The whole story hinges on those shepherds. If it wasn't for them, he would hardly know. And it was to the shepherds that the angels spoke of how much God loved this world. And you know the other amazing thing was? God relied upon the shepherds to tell the story. Can you imagine? Shepherds were not even welcomed into the towns. They were left on the outskirts. Too unclean, too unsavory, too untouchable. Watch what happens. God gave them the story, told them what was going to happen. And you know what they did? They believed it. They believed that story. So much so that they went into Bethlehem, even though that's the last place they would have been welcomed. And they went and they found that child. And then they became the very first missionaries of God. Because they began to tell everybody what they had seen and heard and what they had learned. How do you think we know this story? The shepherds told it. And then another amazing thing happens in this little story. And if you listen to Luke, he tells it carefully. The shepherds told everyone what they had seen and heard. And Mary pondered their words. She pondered what the shepherds had told her. And she kept all of these things in her heart. Now I wonder, as Mary pondered all of those things, as she saw the shepherds come in and then go out, as she heard the good news that they were preaching, I wonder if she pondered for a moment if when you heard that story, you would love her child as well. But as I said in the section of the prophets, perhaps one of the reasons why we still live in a time of darkness, why things still happen in our world. You see, God entered our world, but his good news needed to be preached. His grace and his mercy needed to be shared and extended to all people. God's love needed to be known through this child. And guess who he's entrusted that message with? You thinking it? Do you know who it is? You tell us. You are the ones entrusted with that story. Unto us a boy is born.
Thank you.
next scripture I have for you, you'll probably recognize this one, but not likely from a Christmas Eve service. You probably recognize this one from maybe a wedding or something like that. 1 Corinthians chapter 13. If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions, and if I hand over my body so that I may boast but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient, love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way, it is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. Love never ends. But as for prophecies, they'll come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part. But when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part. Then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. And now faith, hope, and love abide, these three. And the greatest of these is love. Amen. Tonight we talk about the gift of love. But that's what Christmas is all about. You can forget all the other stuff that makes Christmas sparkle and glitter. And understand that Christmas is a gift of love. The gift of love that can be known in the fullness of our life. It can be found in all that we are taught and all that we accept of Jesus Christ, the child of the manger. And this love can shape and determine all that we do. This love is our response to God for all that God has done for us. This love is found in every action and every reaction that we share with one another. This love is the reason we care for one another. And this love is the basis of our hope and our faith in God. So because this gift of love is grace, pure grace, we're never going to do anything to deserve it. We can't give something to buy it. because God gives it. And it is mercy. It is the gift of redemption and salvation given so that we can live in unity with God and with all other people. It is that gift that allows us to live in peace and bring light into our world. It's forgiveness, for it separates us from our sins. And that gift of love actually can grow and envelop us more and more as we seek to learn and to understand the nature of the one who gave it. It grows as did the child who first brought it to us. It matures as we begin to share it as Christ did, when we begin to understand why it's given. It is the fulfillment of prophecy. It is the learning of the words of God. And it is the love that becomes clearer and clearer as we begin to understand that child and why that love was given. Because that love, very simply, has the power to redeem. And that gift of love is a child. Child born in a manger. The same one that Mary pondered, the shepherds rejoiced, and the world has come to know. That child that was born. For you. Oh, come all you faithful. the end of this prayer, I'd like you to do something on your own. We've talked about the gift of love that's been given to us. We recognize that gift of love has to be shared with the world and shared back with God. So at the end of this prayer, I'm going to give you an opportunity to simply contemplate what your gift of love might be on this night. You can say it in prayer. You can share it with someone near to you. But I want you to consider it. Let us pray. God of grace, God of love, God of hope and peace and joy, child in the manger, King of heaven, King of earth, Son of God, and Son of man. We rejoice in the blessing that you represent to us. And we thank you for that gift of love. Lord, send your spirit to be near to us as we contemplate the gift we return to you.
Well, I hear that most of you decided to keep that to yourself. Did you hear that too? You didn't hear anything being said, did you? Did anybody want to share with us? I know it's a silly question.
You're not turned on.
I'm not turned off either. How's that?
Batteries are good. We're good. Do I have to go through all that again? Or did you get it the first time? And no one changed their mind, right? Okay. Gift of love. They're not going to speak up, so I'll let you.
Thank you.
following our Christmas confession, we're going to sing A Little Town of Bethlehem. There's a departing prayer that I'll ask you to join me in. And then when we come to the closing singing of Silent Night, we're going to offer you the light from the Christ candle. And there will be a couple people come down the center aisle, and they will light a candle for you. It seems fairly straightforward, but when we light the candles, the candle will be held for you. You light your candle from theirs. And then you hold your candle, and the person beside you will light their candle from yours. The reason we don't tip the lit candles is because wax and flames will drop. So it's easier just hold your candle, let the next one light from yours. Okay. I'm going to ask you to join me in our Christmas confession. I believe in Jesus Christ and the beauty of the gospel begun in Bethlehem.
I believe in the one whose spirit glorified the little town, and whose spirit still brings joy to people all over the world, in towns both large and small.
I believe in the one for whom the crowded inn could find no room. And I confess that my heart still sometimes wants to exclude Christ from my life today.
I believe in the one who the rulers of the earth ignored, and the proud could never understand, whose life was among common people, whose wealth became the curses of hungry hearts.
I believe in the one who proclaimed the love of God to be invincible.
I believe in the one whose cradle was his mother's arms, whose modest home in Nazareth had love for its only wealth. Who looked at people and made him see what God's love saw in them, who by love brought sinners back to purity and lifted human weakness up to meet the strength of God.
I confess the many things that stand in the way of true celebration of God's love.
I confess those things in my life that have caused me to become separated from my God, my neighbors, and myself.
Moment for silent prayer. I confess my everlasting need of God.
The need of your forgiveness for selfishness and greed. The need of new life for empty souls. The need of love for hearts grown cold.
I believe in God who gives us the best of himself.
I believe in Jesus, Son of the living God, born in Bethlehem this night, for me and for the world.
O little town of Bethlehem. prayer. It's the prayer that Simeon said when he saw Jesus brought into the temple to be blessed in the temple. And these are his words. For let your servants now depart in peace, according to your word. For our eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all people, a light to lighten the Gentiles, and the glory of your people Israel. Amen. O silent night. This place, not only into the night, but into the light and the love of Jesus Christ. Take it into your heart, but don't leave it there. Share it with all that you meet. Go in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.